Before I get to book, I want to talk to you. So there's a narrative that begins in terms of politics, or an important one, beginning in Lebanon about 1983. But it threads through, like looking at what's happening now in Egypt. Does Egypt surprise you?
There have been so many events, as you suggest, from the Marine barracks bombing in Beirut, Lebanon, and the USS Cole, and the first attack on the World Trade Center, the Khobar Towers bombings, attacks on our embassy in Lebanon. And all of those occurred in a sequence, and in almost every instance, they were treated as law enforcement problems. They were, people were indicted in absence. Missiles were fired off from time to time, but they never were connected as a problem of broadly of terrorism and of people determined to kill Americans and civilians and to impose their view against the nation state.
Now, in talking about that, though, is that you looking back now and seeing what Lebanon was like, or at the time, like in Beirut, because you spent time there, did you think we weren't, you know, at that point, that we should be taking it as more than a law enforcement matter?
Clearly, as I discuss in the book, I gave a speech at the U.S. Army Association in 1984, I believe, and I talked about the fact that a terrorist can attack at any place, at any time, using any technique, and it's not possible to defend against a terrorist attack at any moment of the day or night against any technique. And the fact that we needed to treat it as a national security problem rather than a series of isolated events. George Shultz also gave a speech back in 1985 on that subject. And I guess the short answer to your question is that we both saw it as a problem of a different order than it was being considered at that time.
You know, it's interesting watching today's event in Egypt, and, you know, everybody's so uncertain what's going to happen and uncertain what we should do at the time. And then time goes on, we get to look back and we think, well, we should have done it this way.
Well, you're right, but anyone who thinks they know of certain knowledge what's going to take place in Egypt or other countries in the Middle East, I think are probably not going to be correct. When you have this kind of turmoil and this kind of concern and uprising, it is not clear exactly how it will shake out over a period of time. One has to hope for the best and hope that private diplomacy is taking place, but the forces at work are varied. Some really want a freer political institution or a free economic or economic opportunity. Others are hardcore radicals who are determined to ultimately take control. And you can have a very broad popular uprising and have it not end up in a democracy or a freer political situation, but a small group like in Iran take over the country and impose their will because they happen to be the best organized and the most disciplined and the most vicious.
You met Saddam Hussein person. You also met President Mubarak. Let me start with President Mubarak. If he were sitting here, what would I think about? What's he like?
Well, he's husky. He was an ex-Air Force pilot. He used to play squash before he was 82. I met him first when Sadat was acting president of the Republic after the death of Nasser. And then we were together in Salzburg when President Ford was meeting with President Sadat, and he was the brand new vice president. And we were off to the side meeting and talking about flying and the Air Force and the United States Navy. He tended to have a lot of energy. However, here we are, these many years since he's become president, and the circumstance of the people of Egypt, they've not experienced a movement towards freer political institutions. They've not experienced a movement towards freer economic circumstances. And the demographics in that part of the world are tough. There are enormous fraction of the people are young. And the degree of unemployment in those countries is gigantic. And that makes it difficult for the leaders. What was it Churchill said? Dictators or autocrats tend to ride tigers and they're afraid to get off.
Everybody wonders why he just won't leave. I mean, he's dug his heels in and it's getting more dangerous. Everyone worries that tomorrow after the call of prayers it's going to get very violent because people thought today that he would leave and there was all the expectation.
Well, you know, try to put yourself in his shoes. On the one hand, you could make an argument from a personal standpoint that he'd prefer to go out with some dignity over some period of time and not be thrown out. Then you can put yourself in his shoes and say you could make a rational case. that he cares about Egypt, he recognizes the ferment, and he is apprehensive that that ferment could lead to a radicalized country, a damage to the country, damage to the people of Egypt, and that he would be willing to take the risk of trying to see that the transition is more orderly and have the military and he or his designees work over a period of time between now and September and see if they can't structure a soft landing.
So you think it's a good motive rather than a stubborn motive like I'm president?
It could be either one.
Could be either.
I can't climb in his head. I think it's one of those two things, and it could even be a blend.